Sebastian Zellman. One more quick announcement. Just a reminder for the young adults in Brunon, we're going to have a meeting today during ONIF, a Beta meeting. If you're between ages 21 and 35, please come, and we're going to talk about some events and things we plan on doing, and we want your input. So we'll be at these two tables right here inside the fellowship hall. So come in as soon as service is over for ONIF. Join us over there.
Shabbat shalom, everyone. It's an honor and a blessing to be with me here today with y'all to worship our Creator. And I'm just going to invite you all to let go of everything that could possibly get in the way of having that deep and profound connection with Yeshua. Because whatever we hold on to, it makes less room for Him. And as Sami sang last week, overall the lyrics were empty, my heart of all of me, so you can have your all in me. And we just want Yeshua to take over our lives and to fill us with overflowing. And so let's just relax, take some deep breaths, and close our eyes and imagine ourselves falling into Him. And Him not only catching us, but embracing us and filling us with His love and His light. You know, like that trust exercise where they have them. You fall back and the partner catches you, and sometimes they drop you, and sometimes they're not paying attention and they just let you fall. But anyway, but human beings, they will always disappoint you at one point or another, but our God, our amazing, omnipotent, all-powerful God who never changes, always has our back. Amen?
Amen.
So let's put our trust in Him this morning. And let's not stress. Let's not stress about all the things that we don't have to stress about. Let's just wait on Him and meditate on Him. Scripture tells us to sing a new song to Him. So let's praise Him and minister to Him and allow Him to fill us with His songs this morning. Weapons of our warfare are not physical. They're spiritual. And if we put our trust and our hope in Yeshua, He will bring down those strongholds. All of those strongholds. The strongholds of the enemy. Amen? Amen. So let's worship our King and proclaim Him to the nations. Y'all ready to sing?
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's get up and sing a new song to our Lord. And let's worship Him from the heart. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Oh,
worship.
Just as he who calls you is holy, so be holy in all you do, God says. Be holy because I am holy. Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. We are all here just passing through, and we weren't redeemed with perishable things like silver and gold. We were redeemed with the blood of Yeshua, pure and perfect, and he was, and he is, and he is to come. And it's for him that we should live our lives. And God will take care of the rest. Amen?
Priests to his God. and Father. To him be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds. He is coming with the clouds. And every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and was and is to come.
Thank you. first, I want to say happy birthday to Isaac and Israel. Who turned, what, four today? And also, there are a couple other things I want to do. There's a couple of babies that are really in need of prayer. One of Pammy Revitson's friends had two little babies that were born co-joined. And they're sharing one heart. And so I want us to take a moment and pray for them. And then also, Misha, what's the name of the little girl that we've been praying for? Do you remember?
Julia.
And a little baby's got cancer. There is a possible treatment they found in New Zealand. And so we want to pray for them. And then as we pray for these babies, what I'd like to do is, I was going to have all of the expectant mothers come up and pray over them, but I thought that might take forever. So I thought we would just have them stand and pray for those babies.
Amen.
This morning. So if y'all don't mind standing one more time, I know I told you you could sit, but I was only kidding. So Abba, we just come as a community, and we want to pray for these little babies that have been born. And Father, you are sovereign over all things, and we just place them into your hands, knowing that you are a God of miracles.
Yeah,
and that you are already aware of these babies,
yes.
And long before we were, and that you have them in your hands. You have their families in your hands. And we just want to stand with them praying for wellness.
Yes.
And healing.
Yes.
And restoration for all of these babies. And Father, we just want to pray for our expectant moms. We have four of them now in our congregation. And we just pray for their babies, that you would just let them grow in strength and wellness, that every cell in their body would be formed and created and grow in such a way as you perfectly designed it.
Amen.
And Father, that they would be strong. And Father, that they would have a calling on their life even from the womb.
Yes.
Amen. And we thank you for this, B'Shem Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. You can be seated again. I wanted to remind everybody that we have our Tuba Shabbat Seder tomorrow night here at the synagogue. We invite you to come out at 5 o'clock for that. And bring, there's some items you can bring for that. You can get with Misha or Rivka or some of the other people that might know the answer to what to bring and all that. But we're going to have a good time, and we will go through the Tuba Shabbat Seder. If you're not familiar with Tuba Shabbat, come tomorrow night, and you will be, because I'm going to share about it and lead through the traditional Seder for Tuba Shabbat. Next week, directly after service, all those that are going on the intercongregational cruise, I want to have a meeting with you. It won't take a long time, but I just want to answer a couple of questions, make sure you're all aware of what to do. They have some changes in how they're doing boarding and everything, and I want to make sure everybody gets on the right ship at the right place. Hopefully. Well, most of them. But we want that to happen. And we have a Purim festival coming up. And it says, we're looking for singers, dancers, puppeteers, jugglers, fire eaters, what are musketeers? Isn't that like a candy?
We can bring those.
So anyhow, that's coming up on March the 21st. It's going to be at 12 o'clock in the afternoon, a great time for your kids. And also, if you are a vendor of Avon, Mary Kay, Tupperware, Pampered Chef, essential oils, homemade crafts, artwork, anything family-friendly or kid-themed. We want to give you an opportunity to display your stuff and hopefully sell some of it and also bless the congregation, the community. There is a writer's contest. And I've talked to some of you, especially those in my Hebrew class, and you guys are good at making up stories. So there's a deadline of March 1st for the contest. It's with Jewish Voice Ministries International. By the way, didn't Jack, Rabbi Jack, some of you have been doing a fantastic job. I'm really good. Anyhow, there are four different categories you can write in: identity and experience, history and theology, Jewish life and culture, current events, Israel and Middle East, and you can win up to $25,000 in cash and prizes. So that's a good opportunity for somebody. Now, let's just take a breath. It's all right. I've got about a 3-hour message today. So I'm not starting yet. But I just want to make you aware of that. And I'm so, by the way, blessed by the babies being born in our community. We're going to get the congregation to grow one way or the other. So we appreciate your participation in advancing the congregational growth rate. Who's doing liturgy? You are? Okay. So we're going to enter into our time of liturgy. Sometimes people forget that this is a form of worship and praise. It's something we should do from the depths of our being as we sing these prayers that have been prayed and sung by our people for thousands of years in unity with them as they're praying them all over the world. So if you would rise and join us and join in as Catherine leads us in worship.
Thank you, Rabbi. I just want to add, as someone who's not Jewish, it is an honor to participate, not only in Shabbat, but also the other festivals and singing liturgy. I love being connected to that. Remember? Yishak is mine. And with joy, you shall draw forth water from the fountains of salvation.
Thank you.
Sabbath day to keep it holy.
6 days shall you labor and do all your work.
But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work.
For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. But that is why the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it.
Speak also to the children of Israel, saying, above all my Sabbaths you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies you. They shall know. The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat, observing it throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day the rest of them was refreshed. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Shabbat to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, said the Lord.
They shall rule the day Israel.
You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Sanctified be his great name in the world which he has created according to his will.
May he establish his kingdom during your life and during your days and during the life of the whole house of Israel, even swiftly and soon, and say,
Amen.
Amen. Let his great name be blessed forever unto all eternity. Blessed, praised, and glorified, exalted, extolled, and honored, magnified and lauded be the name of the Holy One, blessed is he. Though he be high above all the blessings and songs, praises and consolations which are uttered in the world, and say,
Amen.
May there be abundant peace from heaven and life upon us and upon all Israel, and say,
Amen.
May he who makes peace in his high places make peace upon us and upon all Israel, and say,
Amen.
Yid gadal v'yid kadash me'rabah, v'almad yibrak yirteh v'yam lif ma'fiteh, v'chai akon v'yom akon v'chai v'chol v'yid Yisrael, v'agdalah v'zman kari v'imru,
Amen.
Yehesh me'rabah m'horak l'alam alom me'amayah, Yid Barak, Yid Shabbat, Yid Pahar, Yid Ramam, Yid Nasei, Yid Hadar, Yid Alei, Yid Alal, Shmei Kudusha, Brifu. Le'alam, Yid Koberta, Ta, Vashirata, Tush, Vachata, Vanechamata, Damiram, Ba'alma, Benru.
Amen.
Yehei Shalom, Rabba, Yid Shemai, Vachai, Malena, Ba'al Israel, Benru.
Amen.
Vasei Shalom, Ben Ramav, Hu Yaseh Shalom, Alenu, Ba'al Kobe Israel, Benru.
Amen.
And if you will all stand one more time, as the children will make their way to the front. And I realized when I announced that we had four ladies that are pregnant, that I didn't announce which four that was, so that you would know who to pray for. So the four are Catherine Loughlin, Katrina Bocamp, Hannah Wonder. I wonder where she is. Okay. And the latest to make the announcement, Nefertiti. So happy for Keith and Nefertiti, and excited to watch you as you go through this journey and cheer you on from a distance. So please be praying for all of them, and especially for the little ones. The best looking, the best behaved, the most excited about Yeshua young people in the world. Amen.
Yerushalayim, Baruch.
before you. For from Zion will go forth the word, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Blessed be he who in his holiness gave the Torah to the people of Israel. Amen. Raise your hand toward these amazing children. Abba, Father, we're just so blessed to have each and every one of these children. We love them, and I know that you love them even more than we do. We pray that they would know you, that they would know Yeshua as their Mashiach, that they would walk in your ways all the days of their life. And Abba, that they would be world changers for you. Hashem Yeshua Meshachinu. Amen. And they should go out with joy and live forward with peace. After Pharaoh had let the people go, God did not lead them along the road to the land of the Philistines, although it was nearby. For God said that people might change their minds if they see war and return to Egypt. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher nachan lanu torat emet v'chayei olam etah b'tochenu. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu haTorah. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the Torah of truth and has planted eternal life in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah.
V'zot haTorah asher sam Moshe lifnei bnei Yisrael b'Adonai v'yad Moshe.
And this is the Torah that Moses placed before the children of Israel at the command of the Lord from Moses' hand. Amen. Joe is going to be reading from the Haftorah this morning from the book of Judges, chapter 4, beginning at verse 4. The blessing for reading before reading the Haftorah is found on page 69 in your Siddur.
Baruch atah Adonai, Elohim melech ha'olam. Barav bin bin tolim v'perat atri v'hem hanem alim be'emet. Baruch atah God today. Blessed are you, O Lord God, King of the universe, who selected good prophets and was pleased with the word that spoke truthfully. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, who chooses the Torah, the servant of Moses, your people Israel, and prophets the truth of the right. Amen. Now Deborah, a woman who was a prophetess, the wife of Lippidoth, was judging Israel at that time. She used to sit under the palm tree of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim. And B'nai Israel came up to her for judgment. Now she went and summoned Barak, son of Abinoam, from Kadesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "Hasn't Adonai, God of Israel, commanded, go march to Mount Tabor and take you 10,000 men of the sons of Naphtali and the sons of Zebulun? Then at Kishon Torah, I will draw out to you Sisera, commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his multitude, and I will give him into your hand." But Barak said to her, "If you are going with me, then will I go, and I will go. But if you are going with me, I won't go. Surely I will go with you," she said. "However, no honor will be yours on the way that you are about to go. For Adonai will sell Sisera into the hand of a woman." Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, Tzidkot haolamim, Tzedik kikol halelot ha'el ha'ne'eman, Ha'me'el ha'mos, ha'mer. Ha'me'el be'osei, ha'me'el u'metir, Tzidkot devav emet ba'tzedek. Ne'eman atahu Adonai Eloheinu, ne'emanim, Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, faithful in all generations, and trustworthy God, who says and does, who speaks and makes it come to pass, all whose words are true and righteous. Faithful are you, O Lord our God, faithful are your words, for not one of your words is turned back unfulfilled. For you are faithful, compassionate God and King. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, God who is faithful in all his words. Amen.
Thank you. Cindy will be reading from our Brit Hadashah portion from 2 Corinthians 8, beginning at verse 1. The blessings are on page 71 in your Siddur.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu mashiach yeshua, v'hayi brot shel habrit hakadoshah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu habrit hakadoshah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua and the words of the new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Now we have made known to you, brothers and sisters, the grace God has given to the Messiah's communities in Macedonia, that in much testing by affliction, the abundance of their joy and their extreme poverty overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For I testify that according to their ability, and even beyond their ability, they gave with their own free will, begging us with much urging for the favor of sharing in the relief of affliction. Moreover, it was not just as we had hoped, but they gave of themselves first to the Lord and then to us in keeping with God's will. So we urge Titus that just as he had made a start before, so he should also complete this gracious service for you. For as you excel in everything, in faith and speech and knowledge and all diligence, and in your love for us, also excel in this grace. I am saying this not as a command, but I am trying to prove by the diligence of others the genuineness of your love as well. For you know the grace of our Lord Yeshua the Messiah, that even though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, so that through his poverty he might become rich. Now I give my opinion in this matter, that it is a credit to you that a year ago you were the first to start, not only to do, but even to be willing. but now finish doing it, so that just as there was eagerness to be willing, so also to finish it out of what you have. For if the eagerness is present, the gift is acceptable according to what a person has, not according to what he doesn't have. For it is not relief for others and hardship for you, but as a matter of equality. Your abundance at this present time meets their needs, so that their abundance may also meet your need, so that there may be equality. As it is written, who gathered much and did not have too much, and he who gathered little did not have too little. Baruch atah Adonai, Elohim HaMelech HaOlam, Asher Natan Lanu, Hadabar HaEmet, Mekadosh Baruch atah. Baruch atah Adonai, Elohim HaBarit HaKadoshah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the word of truth and has put the life everlasting in our midst.
Everyone will rise as we return the Torah to the ark. But the scripture's clear about making sure we don't change scripture. So I know that I'll hear about that later. But it's just important that when it comes to where we're actually quoting scripture, that we quote the scripture. Lots of folks out there quote, not quoting scripture, and that gets us into all kinds of problems. So, with that said, I love my wife, and she's such a blessing, and did a great job, and thank you, Catherine, and Tamara, and Robert, and Tamara's husband, Joe, for doing our leading us in worship, and thank you for participating. This week we're reading Beshalach. Beshalach, it begins in the 13th chapter of the book of Exodus. It's the story of Israel as they're leaving Egypt. Last week they began their heading out, but this week we follow them as they lead, and we not only follow them as they leave Egypt and cross the Red Sea, and we see the miracle of the parting of the sea, and we see the people walking across, and it's important for us to remember that before God parted the Red Sea, all of the Israelites trusted him enough to pack their stuff and leave. There's a real lesson in God performing miracles as a response to our faith in him and his word. He said, get up and go. They listened. They got up and they left. And it was at that demonstration of their faith that God worked miraculously and parted the waters. Now, I want to say this. While I say they demonstrated great faith in packing up their bags and borrowing stuff and going with their matzah, their unleavened bread, and all the stuff that they did, while they were still traveling, they were still questioning. It is not a lack of faith to question what's happening. It's a lack of faith to question what's happening while not doing what you've been told to do. And it's important for us to note that the children of Israel were quote, why are we going? What's going on? Why drink the waters here? The Egyptians are behind us. We're all going to die. And in the midst of both their demonstration of faith to be obedient and their demonstration of questioning, God divides the waters and they walk across on dry ground. Now I say that largely because many of us struggle in the miraculous. Have faith for it, to believe for it. But it doesn't take faith to do the simple things that God said to do. And when we do what he says, just by being obedient, it opens the door for the miraculous to take place in our lives. Even if at the time it's happening, we're still questioning. Amen? Okay, so this is happening. They're going through. We see in this week's parasha the quail, the manna, the waters at Marah that are bitter and then are turned sweet. All of those things happen within the scope of this week's parasha. This week's parasha, Israel enters something unique. And before I get into that, I want to read this. And the reason I'm reading this and the reason I'm going in the direction I am is because there are many people here today that weren't here when we did this parsha last year. Many of you have come to a Messianic synagogue, some of you for the very first time today, and you're trying to figure all this stuff out, and who you are, and what you should do, and how does God interact with me, and how do I interact with him, and how do I interact with his people, and how, you know, all of the questions. These are the exact same questions that the Israelites are experiencing at this point in time. They've been living in Egypt for 400 years. They've been living as Jews in Egypt for 400 years. They have somewhat assimilated into Egyptian culture, although they've also hung on to their Jewish traditions. They could be identified as Hebrews, as children of Israel, even amongst the Egyptians, even at the end of the 400 years. So they hung on to their identity to some extent while assimilating their identity also. And so I know there are people here that have come to our congregation over the last year, and some maybe even longer than that, And a big part of what we deal with is finding our identity in our faith. Did somebody fall asleep already?
No,
my
car seat fell off.
Oh, your car seat fell off. No baby in the car seat. Okay. By the way, before I go on, Jim Street is at West Florida Hospital in room 605. If you get a chance, go by and visit him. He's doing okay, but he is in the hospital. They're trying to figure out what's wrong with him. His wife's been trying that for years. I don't know. Just pray for him and go by and visit him if you can. So I thought I would read from this little thing that we give out to everybody who comes that most people don't actually look at. And so I thought I would read it. Our mission. We exist to be a Yeshua-centered, Torah-observant community of believers, both Jewish and non-Jewish. Our goal is to share the entirety of God's Word, which is made up of the Tanakh and Brit Hadashah, the what's known as the Old Covenant, or Old Testament, and the New Testament, with all peoples from all nations. Our vision, our example is that of our Messiah Yeshua and his Talmudim, or the disciples. Our faith is biblical Judaism, which is the faith handed down to us by God through his chosen people, beginning with God's covenant with Adam, continuing to his covenant with Abraham, extending through the Sinai covenant, and completing with the Brit Hadashah or Renewed Covenant. We find it totally consistent to be followers of Judaism and the Jewish Messiah, Yeshua. Now, I read that because it's important to know, for you to know, what it is that we believe and are doing here, because there are some times when people come to our congregation or to congregations like it with the intent of converting that congregation to their way of thinking, to make us become what they are, and that's not going to happen here. And if that is your goal, if you came so that you could make us like you, I encourage you strongly to pray and then find somewhere else to go. And if during the prayer God changes your heart and mind, then welcome. So the people of Israel are coming out of Egypt, and they're experiencing something that hasn't been experienced since the Garden of Eden. Think about it. In the Garden of Eden, there was no sickness, no disease. All of that didn't exist in the Garden of Eden. And the Lord says to the children of Israel, if you'll follow my commandments, none of the sickness and disease of Egypt will come upon you. So they're entering this sacred, holy space with Adonai that is similar to the Garden of Eden. In the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve didn't have to fight weeds and all that kind of stuff. They just went out and picked the food they wanted to eat. And in the wilderness, God provided manna, so all they had to do was go out of their tent and pick up the food. In the Garden of Eden, they wore one set of clothes. And in the wilderness, they didn't have their clothes wearing out or their shoes. Second greatest miracle in the Bible. That about a million women were satisfied with one pair of shoes for 40 years. I'm just saying, that's, you know, if you doubt the power of God, that's proof. The second greatest miracle in the Bible is found in the Brit Hadashah on the New Covenant. It said, and the saying pleased the whole multitude. I'm still praying for the fulfillment of that. And I know that even this morning as I'm sharing, some of you are already wondering, does this saying please me? So, children of Israel are going, they're having this new experience with Adonai, where they're in his presence. He is physically and tangibly with them, just like he was with Adam and Chava in Gan Eden, in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. They looked, they saw him. At least his the cloud and the pillar. All of this is happening as they're being redeemed from Egypt. But in their redemption, they had no idea what to do next. It reminded me when I read this of when I joined the Navy. Anybody other than me serve in the military, thank you for your service, all those that have. I went to boot camp. And when I went into boot camp, I thought myself a reasonably intelligent individual. I got dressed. I went to work. I came home from work. I called my friends. I went with my friends. I went to synagogue. I did the different things that we do in life. If I was hungry, I went to the restaurant, or I made myself a PB&J sandwich or a bagel. I made decisions. It was not beyond my comprehension to be able to decide what to do next. When I joined the Navy, they sent me to boot camp. And at the end of boot camp, they sent me, gave me a ticket. They sent me from Orlando to Wilmington, Tennessee. And they gave me instructions, go check in. And I went and I checked in. And after I checked in, which was on a Friday, they said, come back Monday. I was like, what am I going to do till Monday? What? I don't understand. Well, just come back Monday. But where am I supposed to go till Monday? Go to the barracks. But I don't know what, because every day for 10 weeks, they told me when to get up and when I was going to eat and what I was going to wear and how I was going to wear it, where I was going to go, what I was going to do. And all of a sudden, after 10 weeks, I did not have the capacity to make a decision about what I was going to do at first. And then I thought, I haven't slept on a real bed for 10 weeks. I'm going to a hotel. I'm going to rent a bed. And I'm not getting out of the bed until Monday morning. And that's what I did. Of course, not long after I got out of the Navy, I got married, and that kept me from having to make decisions ever again. But the children of Israel... Children, we'll delete that from the recording. The children of Israel are coming out of Egypt where they've been slaves. They were servants. They were limited in what they could do, where they could go, how they could go, all of that. And now they're coming out of that, and they're being miraculously drawn and led. God is with them. He is speaking to Moses. Moses is speaking to them. And that's where they are. They're like, what do we do now? Which is why they're wondering, well, if this water is bitter, how are we going to get sweet water? And what are we going to eat? Back in Egypt, we had lots of meat. And now we don't have, and all of that stuff going on. This isn't so much rebellion as being lost. What am I going to do now? How am I going to live now? Now that I'm no longer that, exactly what am I? And how am I going to live? And what am I going to do? Now that I'm not that, what exactly am I? And how do I walk out what I am? It's interesting that just as the Garden of Eden analogy continues, in the Garden of Eden, the Lord says, this is what you don't eat. They come out of Egypt. And he gives them instructions on what to eat. You can eat manna. Now, I want you to think about this with me, because it's important that we as a community get this next concept in our minds and in our hearts. And that is that we are only in Exodus 17, 13 through 17 this week. Right? You can nod your heads, it's true. When does Hashem speak from the mountain? Exodus 20. Right? So, Torah, as we describe it, is given to Moses on the mountain. God speaks from the mountain. That happens in Exodus 20, And between Exodus 20 and Exodus 34, when he does it the second time, yet in Exodus 13, the Lord tells them, I'm sorry, 15, the Lord tells them, if you'll obey my commandments,
right,
none of the sicknesses of the Egyptians will come upon you. He also tells them they have to obey the Sabbath in this parsha before he speaks from the mountain the 10 words, the 10, what's known as the 10 commandments. All of that happens as he gives the whole 613 commandments. Doesn't happen until 3 chapters after where we are now. And yet, Adonai is speaking to them of observing commandments and statutes now, even though Exodus 20 doesn't happen for how long from now? How many years is it between when they come out? Okay, I'm not going to answer that for you, because it'd be good if you studied. Look it up yourself. It didn't happen the next week. There's a period of time that goes by between when they're told, if you obey my commandments, you will not have the sicknesses of Egypt, and when we see him vocally give commandments from the mountain. It's important for us to note the children of Israel understood there were commandments before the Torah was spoken and given on Mount Sinai. It's important for us to note that. We have a lot of issues as community, and we argue about things like, is there an oral Torah? And I want to share a little about this today. Because the answer to that question is, it depends what you mean by Torah. If you mean by Torah that when Moses wrote down the Torah, that God gave him this exhaustive list of instructions along with it, then I don't believe there's an oral Torah, because the scripture actually says, and Moses wrote down everything God told him. However, if you use the word Torah to mean instructions, then I absolutely believe there is an oral Torah. Because we see all kinds of instructions before we see Torah. And God instructs Adam and Eve not to eat the fruit in the garden. Cain and Abel know what a good or bad offering is. Noah knows what clean and unclean animals are. There's a commandment first not to eat meat, and then there's a commandment that's okay to eat meat. There's lots of instructions. We see the Sabbath exists before the 20th chapter of Exodus. So there are instructions that God has given his people before they get to Sinai. So are there oral instructions or written instructions? When I say oral instructions, I mean, did God speak them to people who then spoke them to other people? And the answer is, there has to be. Did those become the oral law? I don't think so. I think some of them made it in. But the oral law contains all kinds of things I don't agree with that are contrary to the Torah. And we need to be careful about that, because the oral law is also codified by rabbis that don't believe in Yeshua. And we need to be careful about that. But that doesn't mean that we don't have to understand that as God was speaking to mankind, he was giving them instructions, and they understood they were instructions. Recently, and the reason that this weighed so heavy on my heart, Rabbi Michael Stepakoff gave a message at the rabbis' conference last week, or the week before, whenever it was. And he shared a message about identity and about the problem that we as Messianic, especially Messianic Jews, somewhat Messianic Gentiles, not in the same way, have, because He was speaking to a pastor who just couldn't believe he was a believer in Yeshua because he still lived as a Jew. And so, you know, you can't believe in Yeshua because all that Old Testament stuff was done away with. And if you were really a believer in Yeshua, you wouldn't hold any of that stuff. And so you're not really a believer. So that was in this coffee house. That conversation happened. And then a Jewish guy came up to him and said, "I understand you're one of those people. The Jews who believe in Yeshua people." And he said, "You can't be Jewish and believe in Yeshua." So the Christian pastor was saying, "You can't be Christian and be Jewish." And the Jew was saying, "You can't be Jewish and believe in Yeshua." In other words, if you're Jewish and you accept Yeshua, you become a Gentile from both sides. Because that's what they're saying. Leave the covenant people of God and become part of the nations. If you're Jewish and you accept Yeshua, you leave Jewishness, become part of the nations. If you are Jewish and become a believer in Yeshua, from the Jewish people's perspective, many of them think you can't be Jewish and believe in Yeshua. So he gave this whole talk about how all these interactions went. It was a very good talk, and I encourage, we're getting the MP3 of it, I encourage all of you to listen to it. Because not only was it well taught, it was entertaining while it was being well taught. So I think you'll like it. But we live in that realm. And so recently, we have had a lot of Jews for Judaism, the anti-missionaries, all that going on, that have been attacking Messianic Jews. You know, we had a Messianic leader who prayed at Mike Pence rally, and the Jewish community raised up and said, "You're not really Jewish," all that stuff went on. But also recently, we've had a number of well-known pastors who have risen up to make really... fill in the blank statements about Messianic Jews. And following the Torah and living in that way. And so, for instance, Andy Stanley not only made the statement that that believers had to unhitch the Old Testament from their faith, but he went on even deeper to say, you don't know, not even just Jews, but no believer, Jew or Gentile, has an obligation or responsibility to the Ten Commandments. He went so far as to say that believers don't even have a responsibility to the Ten Commandments.
What's a believer?
We're not taking questions. A local pastor recently gave a part of his message where he was mocking Messianic believers that attend our synagogue because of their decision to walk according to God's instructions. So I want to go over a couple of these things, and I've got 6 minutes before my second hour begins. So, there's a lot of things I want to cover, and this is important, and honestly, if you just absolutely have to go, quietly get up and go. I don't know how long I'm going to take, but I think it's important. I may be done in 5 minutes, and this all may be irrelevant. So I want to talk about a couple of things. One is the question of, are we what is known as one law? There's a doctrine called one law, which, by the way, I think is about the dumbest way we could name something we were for or against. Because you start out with a negative position, because the scripture says there's one law, several places. So if you say I'm not one law, then you automatically sound like you're going against the verses that say there's one law. The one law people actually believe something we do not adhere to here at Red Hawk. They believe that every commandment is applicable and to be followed by every person, regardless of whether they're Jewish or non-Jewish. We don't agree with that for a number of reasons. Some of you are women. And there's not one commandment given to men that you women can follow. At least not yet in Pensacola. Some places it might be. But not here. Some of you are men. And you can't observe the commandments given to women. Some of you are farmers. And some of you aren't. And there's commandments given to farmers. There's some people that are tax collectors. I was hoping Sam was going to be here. There's commandments given to tax collectors. There's commandments given to merchants. They're not given to people who aren't merchants. So not every commandment is applicable to you. There are commandments that are only given to Jewish people. There are. I'll give you one example. It says for the Jews to be a light to the nations. That's a commandment. And not one Gentile can fulfill that commandment, no matter how much they want to. It's impossible. There's other arguments we can argue about different commandments, who has to keep this one or that one. But there are commandments that are specifically given only to the Jewish people, and that's okay. And you don't have to become Jewish to be born again. The whole book of Galatians is written to tell Gentiles that they don't have to physically become Jewish to become part of the commonwealth of Israel. So we are not one law. We do, however, believe that there is one law that is to be obeyed by everybody as it is applicable to the individual. Just like there's one God. It's all. So we're not one law, but we are. But we're one law the right way, not one law the wrong way. I'm sure I'm going to get emails about this. We are not to unhitch the Old Testament from our faith, and we are to keep not only the Ten Commandments, but every other commandment that God gave us to keep. Not in order to be redeemed, but because we are. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And, contrary to modern teaching, if you keep his commandments, the blessings for keeping the commandments become applied to your life. If you don't keep the commandments in this world, you will reap the results of not following his commandments. The Gentiles in Torah, we believe, that Gentiles should follow all of the Torah that is applicable to Gentiles. Now, I know that I have friends and brethren, and you'll read about them on the internet as they argue amongst themselves, who argue about that. Say Gentiles shouldn't keep certain that because it dulls or diminishes or dilutes the Jewish identity that God instilled in his word. My answer to that is very simple. If you eat chicken soup with matzo balls in a Jewish deli served to you by a Jewish bubby that was made according to the recipe of all of her ancestors back to Adam, and you're a Gentile, nobody is going to think you're diluting Jewish identity by eating matzo ball soup in a Jewish deli served to you by Jewish people, surrounded by other Jewish people. If you make matzo ball soup in your home and it looks like pasta fagioli, there will be an identity issue. Okay? The nations, as they became believers, were supposed to attach themselves to Israel. Paul calls it being grafted into the commonwealth of Israel. You become part of the commonwealth of Israel. You don't replace the Jewish people, you come alongside the Jewish people.
Amen.
I have absolutely no fear that the non-Jewish members of this congregation are going to make Jewish people think our congregation is less Jewish because they keep the Shabbat, or the Feast of Festivals. As a matter of fact, all of our friends from Bnei Israel that have come and visited make comments about how Jewish we feel and are, and how much life and enthusiasm there is in our worship. And Sherry Gordon, a good friend who has spoken here before, said, "Your congregation's vision is the vision I've been trying to get through the head of our rabbi. That we need to get the Gentiles to come and walk alongside of us as the Gentiles walked alongside of the Israelites as they left Egypt."
Amen.
The problem comes not with Gentiles doing Sabbath and Moedim and other things alongside the Jewish people. The problem comes when they separate from the Jewish people, because that's where the Catholic Church comes from. When identity changed because there was no connection anymore to the Jewish people. Should Gentiles eat kosher? Absolutely. Absolutely. I wanted to make a meme. I was going to get in trouble yesterday. Sometimes I think of things and I think, that's a great idea, that's a dumb idea. That's a great idea, that's a dumb idea. I wanted to make a meme that said, "You take the bunny and the pig, I'll take the lamb." I didn't, because I thought it might offend somebody. At least there was a possibility it might. But that's really the message I'm saying, is if you take the Jewish people, the natural olive tree, and you break the wild branch off and attach it to a different tree, or plant it as its own tree, eventually it's no longer what it's supposed to be. But as long as the Gentiles, the people from the nations that accept Yeshua, become part of the people, there is no issue with identity. And I don't think any of the Gentiles in our congregation, and I use it, listen, when I use the word Gentile, I use it because it's biblical, not because it's a down thing. You know, the people that don't call us Gentiles call us Ger. Ger means stranger. And while some of you are, it's probably not the best word to use for someone who has become part of. So, if we live the way we're supposed to in our community. Now, when I say these things, I'm talking about at Redon. I have no imagined thought that every church in town is suddenly going to become messianic. I think they should. I don't think, so I'm not out there, like I don't go to first whatever church and stand out with a sign in front of it that says, "Eat kosher or you're going to hell," because I don't believe that anyhow. Or, you know, "If you can count to seven, I'll sing you on Shabbat." Or, you know, "Speak in tongues, learn Hebrew." Or any things like that. Because we're supposed to be a light to the nations that attracts them to the ways of God. So when I talk of these things, I'm talking about in our community. In our community, if you're Jewish, you should abide by the halakha of our community. The way we do things. And we do them as much as we can according to the Torah. If you're non-Jewish, you should attach yourself alongside and walk alongside us as one.
Amen.
When they, the Bible says there's neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, free or bond, it wasn't so the Jews could act like Gentiles. Because the last part of the verse says, "For you are all one in Messiah." The middle wall of partition wasn't broken down so the Jews could escape. It was broken down so the Gentiles could have fellowship and become part of God's people. All of these things are important because the more we stand up, the more people are going to say things against what we believe. In the discussion, Andy Stanley says, we need to unhitch the Torah, the Old Testament, from our faith, because the God of the Old Testament appears to be so mean, and he tells people to kill people, and he's very judgmental. He's just very judging. So I encourage him to read Luke chapter 10. When Yeshua, by the way, this is in, you know, Yeshua's writing. It's the red stuff. I tell you, it would be more tolerable for Sodom on that day than for that town. Woe unto you, or woe to you, Chorazin, woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the miracles done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have turned along and gone, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. Yet it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon at judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, you won't be lifted up to heaven, will you? No, you will go down to Sheol. The one who listens to you hears me, and the one who rejects you rejects me, and the one who rejects me rejects the one who sent me. Sounds a whole lot like that guy from the first part of the book, doesn't it? It's because it's the same guy. It's the same book. It's the same thing. It's interesting that in Exodus 15:26, it says, if you diligently listen to the voice of Adonai your God, do what is right in his eyes, pay attention to his mitzvot, and keep all his decrees, by the way, 15, not 20, I will put none of the diseases on you which I put on the Egyptian, for I am Adonai who heals you. But it doesn't stop there. The next verse is so key and so important. It says, then they came to Elim, where there were 12 springs of water and 70 palm trees. So they camped there by the waters. 12 springs, 12 tribes, 70 palm trees, 70 nations. So important for us to understand God's purpose was to unite people in faith, not to divide in faith. This isn't about a long list of do's and don'ts. It's about knowing that there is a God who loves us and wants us to be blessed and has provided instructions for that to happen. I love electricity. Everybody like electricity? Anybody not have electricity at your house? I love electricity as long as I abide by the rules of electricity. There have been days I didn't like electricity. You know, when I was wiring my air conditioner into my apartment, and I put the wires backwards, and then I plugged the wire in, and I had a mini revival. I didn't abide by the rules of electricity. And I received the results of not abiding by them. Electricity is a blessing. We all like electricity, but we have to abide by the rules of it. God's word is a blessing, but we have to abide by the rules of it. The reason we have so many crazy things going on in our world is because we stopped abiding by the rules. The rule is one man, one woman, one marriage. Why do we have so many problems? Because people aren't getting married anymore. Supposed to love our children, and yet 55 million of them have been killed in Rome. Why is everything so messed up? It's because we are. Because we're not abiding by his instructions. Instructions aren't a bad thing. Anybody who ever shopped at IKEA knows if they're in English, they're very helpful. start out with pieces, you follow the instruction, you end up with an end table, or a shelf unit, or a microwave stand, or something. I told somebody the other day, a stereo cabinet, and they said, a what? They were, you know, under 20, they'd never seen a stereo. We need to understand what God's purpose and point in all of this is. When Israel left Egypt, they were lost identity-wise. And this week's Parsha, they begin the groundwork for establishing and reestablishing their identity as the people of God. When we come to faith, whether we come from Judaism or we come from no faith at all, or we, even when we come from a Christianity that is not biblically sound, we have the same experience. There's a supernatural thing that takes place and our hearts change. And suddenly we go, now that I'm not that, what am I? And I'm telling you, the answer to what am I is in the Bible, not in commentaries. It's not in modern theology. It's for Jewish people to look at Judaism and say, what in there is actually in the book? And for Christians to look at Judaism and say, what in there is actually in the book? And then for us to start doing those things. And it's interesting that as we read the things God does in this parsha, he gives a manna, but there's instructions. He didn't just give them manna and they just did whatever they wanted to. Collect it up, don't collect it up. You do what the way I say. And if you do not do what I say, it won't happen. If you don't do more than what I say, it's going to rot. There's instructions. Because every blessing of God comes with instructions, including our redemption by Yeshua. Everyone as part of our community should keep Shabbat, the Moedim, Kashrut, all of the things that are applicable to your life that come from the Torah. And when we do, we will be a light that will draw others to God's presence.
Yes.
Let's all stand. I want to get t-shirts made. Say, hitch your faith to the Old Testament.
Yes.
To open conversation. I think that would open more conversation than you take the bunny and the pig and I'll take the lamb. Although that might open conversations also. It'd be different conversations. But it's important that we understand what our identity is. Our identity is that we are the children of the Most High. Our identity is that there's one God and one people and one word. Our identity is that he made a way for Jew and non-Jew to be one in the Messiah. Our identity is that we're supposed to love one another as we love ourselves. Our identity is we're supposed to act in a manner that produces good fruit, not bad fruit. Our identity is the Word of God, because we're supposed to be Talmudim, or followers of the one that walked it perfectly. It's not that hard if you just stay in the pages and read it the way it was written. Thank you. shared that message on Facebook. Feel free to tag people that might be interested. I'm not talking about animosity. I'm talking about people that would be blessed by it. I want to remind you that if you don't take an offering up, we receive one. There's a tzedakah box by both doors. And that's also a place that you can put your prayer requests. If you are a first-time visitor, come turning your visitor card to me and Miss Robin. Oh, if you need your giving statement for this past year, Robin has them in the office, and you can go pick them up from her. Let me say this very clearly. They are already done. It is your responsibility to come by and get them from Robin, or let her know that you would be glad to receive them by email. She is not going to chase you down like a lion after a gazelle. Gather together with your loved ones. Yevrech et Adonai v'yishmerecha, Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'yichunecha, Yisar Adonai panav elecha v'yasem lecha shalom. Adonai bless you and keep you. Adonai make his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you. Adonai lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Hashem Yeshua Meshachim Yisar Shalom. In the name of Yeshua, our Messiah, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Amen. Also, Ron. Many of you know him as Papa Smurf. He's not feeling well, so please be praying for him. Amen. And if you know who he is, call him and encourage him. There is Hebrew class after... Oh, no. 1 o'clock.